Mesh shaders, ray tracing, and space black finish? No, believe it or not, you didn't just travel back to 2019. You watched Apple's scary fast event announcing, among other things, their latest M3 chip lineup. But while some of what they talked about felt a little yesterday's news, but magical this time, typical Apple, the rest of it was full of some pretty big dunks on the rest of the computer industry, which is also becoming kinda typical Apple. I mean, here, think about all the variety in the world of PC laptops. Apples, by contrast, are downright boring. They don't even have touchscreens, for crying out loud. And yet, they deliver time and again on what matters so effectively that I can't even blame folks for flocking to them. Say it with me, PC industry. Nothing else matters until you get these things right. Power efficiency, performance, and portability. Come to think of it, now that they've got a new process node, the number 3 is everywhere here. 3 nanometer on the M3 chip with 3 main M3 SKUs. The announcement video is 30 minutes, 31 seconds long, held on October the 30th in 2023. What is next? Are they gonna make me write 3 segues to today's sponsor? Hetzner. Hetzner has recently launched their new high-performance cloud servers that now have dedicated vCPUs, which provide a fantastic price-to-performance ratio. Check them out at the link below and use code LTT23 for 20 euros off. Apple's main focus today was showing off, once again, the most powerful laptops we've ever created, which is kind of a no-doy moment. I mean, why would you make a new one that isn't better? But after all those years of Intel missing their tick-tock development cycle and rehashing the same 14 nanometer chips, it kind of makes sense that Apple feels the need to rub some salt in their ex's wounds and clarify that, yes, generational improvements are actually a thing. Let's start with the GPU. They're claiming that their new 3 nanometer hotness is the biggest leap forward in graphics architecture ever for Apple Silicon. And considering what they had before, they're probably right. Hardware accelerated ray tracing and mesh shaders, while nothing new to PC gamers, are certainly going to be a key part of their path toward making games look incredible on the Mac. Alan Wake 2, for example, just came out to rave reviews over their implementations of these key technologies. But while the game looks amazing, older 10 series Nvidia cards struggle with it due to Alan Wake 2's requirement for mesh shaders having dropped support for Vertex shaders altogether. So, while Apple's announcements might not sound impressive if you've been hearing these words for almost half a decade, in typical Apple fashion, they're showing up to the party just in time for their implementation to actually be useful. Kinda smart, really. But they've also got some outright new stuff, like dynamic caching. In a nutshell, M Silicon Macs use unified memory that is shared between the CPU and the GPU, and normally, some portion of that memory would be reserved for the GPU by looking at the maximum amount it could possibly need for the most intense parts of a game or a video editing workload, and then holding that all the time. But now, M3 can dynamically determine exactly, and exactly, how much memory it actually needs in any given moment and allocate that to the GPU. It's on all 3 of the new chips, there's that number again, and it supposedly dramatically increases the average utilization of the GPU. We're gonna have to wait and test it for ourselves, of course, but if it's done well, this is a major benefit of a tightly integrated system. Though you'll be paying a major premium for it, especially if you shell out for the 40-core GPU version of the M3 Max rather than the 30-core base one. Cutting-edge costs, though, and if their vague and nebulous slides are to be believed, M3's performance per watt is about to put even more pressure on the likes of Intel, who recently resorted to rehashing old CPUs again with their 14th-gen desktop processors. 14's really not Intel's number, hey? Speaking of Intel and CPUs, this whole event had major Jilted Ex-Lover vibes, am I right? Like, how many times did they mention Team Blue?
Intel.
But be that as it may, the CPUs on these new chips look very, so long, see you later, don't need ya, impressive. First, not only are the P cores and the E cores 30 and 50% faster than the M1 respectively, but they've improved the branch prediction on both and strategically juiced up core counts, so the regular M3 in the now entry-level 14-inch MacBook, bye-bye 13-inch model, is an 8-core CPU with a 10-core GPU and support for up to 24 gigs of unified memory. The M3 Pro sports 12 CPU cores, 18 cores for graphics, and up to 36 gigs of unified memory. That is a pretty good amount of memory for a laptop. And it's not even close to the Max, the M3 Max that is, that offers up to a whopping 16 CPU cores, up to 40 GPU cores, and up to 128 gigabytes of unified memory, a feature that previously was only seen on desktop Macs. The only thing I don't like about all of this is Apple's de-emphasis on what kind of CPU cores we're looking at. See, this generation, it's not a problem yet because only the Max SKU deviated from their previous 1-to-1 ratio of performance to efficiency cores. And it did so in a positive way with a 3-to-1 split. But I also kind of feel like we're being primed to not think about what kind of cores we're getting so that maybe they could go the other way in the future. But that's for future Linus to complain about. For now, the M3 lineup has more going for it than just a new chip. Apple continues to lead the way on laptop displays with their Liquid Retina XDR display peaking at up to 1600 nits in HDR and 600 nits in SDR, all while running at 120 hertz. That is astonishing for a machine that runs on battery. And speaking of, they couldn't resist taking some shots at Intel over their crummy battery life, boasting that an M3 machine will give Intel Mac owners up to an additional 11 hours of battery life alongside the up to 11x performance uplift. An uplift that is consistent whether you're plugged into the wall or running on the aforementioned battery. That's really cool, because now, if you feel the need to step outside for some fresh air or just to change the scenery, you don't have to worry about a worse digital experience because of it. Just unplug, pop your M3 MacBook into an LTT backpack, which has lots of space for even the 16-inch in there, and an AirTag in the hidden pocket, and walk away. LTTstore.com. But hey, maybe you like having a stationary computer. Where's the love for you? Well, the good news is the new iMac, which comes with a 4.5K display now, is getting the regular M3 chip. The bad news is that's all the love you get. Apple, where the heck are the Pro and Max models, guys? Oh wait, I get it. They probably could have done that, but launching 3 dies across 3 chassis, that seems like it was the right number today. But more will almost certainly follow if Apple's to keep hold of their efficiency crown. The just-announced Snapdragon X Elite looks poised to make the competition a lot more interesting, and Microsoft's decade-plus-long slog to make Windows on ARM a reality feels like it's finally on the cusp of bearing fruit. Of course, most of the comparisons I saw Qualcomm making were to M2, and you can't actually buy any of that stuff today. So if you're looking for something to compete with a MacBook, you'll have to check the links below where we'll have MacBooks. Just don't expect them to be cheap. The 14-inch M3 MacBook is $400 less than the old 14-inch MacBook, so that's cool. But it's also $300 more expensive than the previous entry-level model now that the 13 option doesn't exist anymore. And you'll be paying that price for just 8 gigabytes of unified memory and a wimpy 512 gig SSD. Once you start speccing out the 16-inch versions with the M3 Pro and the M3 Max, well, it doesn't take long to start hitting $3,000, $4,000, or even $7,000. And that's nothing compared to what they've done with the iMac. Sure, it starts at $1,300, but that is with a 256 gig SSD. By the time you put a terabyte of storage in it, you've spent $1,700 on a machine that just has the most basic M3 silicon in it. Man, do these guys ever charge a premium for that sweet, sweet memory and storage. Just like I'm about to charge a premium to our sponsor. Backblaze. Backblaze is an affordable and easy to use cloud backup solution that starts at just $9 a month. They make it so simple. You can back up almost anything from your Mac or your PC and access it from anywhere with their web and mobile apps. So you're always ready to show off your Monk cosplay. Or you can easily protect your business data through a centrally managed admin. You can even restore your data by mail. Backblaze will ship a hard drive with your data on it right to your door, and then you can return the hard drive after for a refund when you're done. And if you're worried about accidentally deleting files, you can increase your retention history to 1 year for free. With over 55 billion files restored and 2 exabytes of data under their management, Backblaze has got you covered. They even have us covered. We back up our servers to Backblaze nightly. So sign up and get a 15-day free trial with no credit card required today at backblaze.com/LTT. Thanks for watching. If you guys like this video, make sure to check out our iPhone 15 coverage from earlier this year. That A15 Pro chip is something else.